Hey, what's up, phone lovers, and welcome to the Mobile Roar podcast for the week of August 29th, 2014. I'm Joe Fedewa.
And I am Christopher Chavez.
And I'm Kevin Krause.
Episode 60, guys. The big 6-0.
6-0, yeah.
Not too shabby, if I do say so myself.
Moving up.
Yep. We are fastly approaching that 100 episode mark. So that. Yes. 40 weeks from now, it's going to be, what month will it be? Math is a thing that people do.
It'll be 3 months before today, so it'll be the end of June, the end of May.
Oh, wow.
The end of May next year.
That's a while from now. Okay, I'm going to stop thinking about that. all right, so we have some pretty exciting stuff to talk about this week, actually, which is cool because it has been kind of slow in August so far, but I think we're going to start ramping up very quickly. And the thing that's been coming out this week, new smartwatches for IFA, IFA, whatever you want to call it. We got some new round smartwatches to look forward to.
Yeah.
LG.
Do you think Motorola, they made them wait for everyone else to get their own round smartwatches? Like, is that part of that whole thing?
I don't know. I mean,
exclusivity deal?
This waiting this long could backfire now, especially since there's going to be these new round watches, because IFA is actually before the Motorola event, correct?
Yeah, that's like, well, ongoing, I think, during...
Right, but all the main stuff is going to be like on next Wednesday.
Oh gosh, it's going to be a busy week.
So I mean, LG's going to show off this round smartwatch on Wednesday, and then Motorola is going to show off the 360 again on Thursday. So if LG really wows us with their round watch, could really dig into Moto 360 sales.
Yeah, but did they wow anybody? I guess that's the bigger question.
Well, not yet. They haven't.
Just looking at that round LG watch, I don't know. I'm not sure how I feel about it.
Wait, yeah, it's the ones that we're getting that are going to be round?
Well, the round one we're talking about is the LG G Watch R, and it has a complete circle display, whereas the 360 has that little tiny chin. But, I mean, the reason why the LG one doesn't have that is because it has a lot more bezel.
Yeah, like, it's technically got bezel around it, even though it's not like a traditional black.
Right. It's disguised to look like one of those little like compass dial things.
I used to love that when I was like a kid. Yeah. It's
just like the normal. It's the bezel that you would normally find on a watch. So it's just like it's a matter of the hardware interacting with the software watch face.
Right. I mean, but. I don't know. It's kind of weird that it has the dial thing because, like, I was talking to Quentin earlier today, and he's like, that dial is going to be completely pointless if you're using, like, a digital watch face.
Yeah, it's going to look silly, depending on which one you use. If you use something more modern or, like, a digital watch face, it's going to be like, why is there a dial around this? But
right. Well, I mean, yeah, I think it's just it's a way to hide the sensors and have a completely circle display without it looking stupid.
I think it's cool. I like it. I think it's a neat way to marry the two concepts of the
it is cool looking.
And
yeah.
I mean, it looks like a legit watch. Like, if you just show someone that picture, no one's going to say, like, oh, is that one of those smart, fancy Android Wear watches? Like, no one's going to even know.
Well, the 360 is like a casual, like, kind of fashion watch, and the G Watch R is more of a sport watch, it looks like to me.
Uh-huh. Yeah. It's interesting that in all the promo shots, it looks like they only show it with the watch face. They don't show it with anything else going on.
Yeah, that's why at first I was trying to decide if the dial was a part of the display. But if you look at some of the pictures, it's like beveled. It's like slanted on a different angle than the display. So I'm almost positive it's not a part of it.
Yeah. Yeah,
but it was kind of funny. I don't know if you guys saw the promo video they did, but they kind of did take a shot at that little chin on the 360.
So dumb. So to me, it's the dumbest thing to get. Like, some people are like kind of bent out of shape over it. Like, why does it have that little bezel at the bottom? It's not totally round, and it's just such a silly thing to get upset about. But the fact that LG noticed, you know.
Do you guys think part of this is that Motorola decided from the beginning that they were going to do a round watch face, so they got to announce theirs alongside the rest of them, but the reason that these other companies waited to announce theirs is because Google had to actually make the circular version of Android Wear before any of them could launch?
I don't think that.
You don't think that has anything to do with it? I mean, it just seems odd that all of these are getting announced right around the time that the Moto 360 is finally about to be available. It seems like there must be something going on behind the scenes. Or else Motorola shouldn't have waited this long because they missed an opportunity to be the only one with a circular watch.
Well, how many months ago was the 360 announced?
A long time ago. I mean, it was announced before Google.
Before the summer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, spring.
So I just wonder if this is how long it takes for everyone to just be like, oh, crap, we need to make a round watch.
I don't think so. I think that Google probably approached these companies, said, here's your options. You can do a round watch or a square watch. Motorola probably only had resources to develop one, and they chose round, and these other companies had the resources to develop multiple versions, and they wanted to go with the square one first, maybe because the software for the round one wouldn't have been ready in time. I don't know. There's got to be something behind the scenes, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I find it really hard to believe that Motorola would be the only one to choose round. I don't know. I feel like that would be a more popular option. I don't know. It's a good question, though. It does make you wonder.
Yeah. So wait, so LG announced a round watch. Did Samsung or someone else have a round watch?
Sort of. Samsung announced a curved watch. And then just to kind of jump on that whole name thing, they announced the like Galaxy Round or something, which is like, it's just a headphones.
No. Galaxy Round is an actual phone, dude.
Gear Circle.
Yeah, it's just headphones that vibrate when you get a call.
As writers, this is going to be a nightmare. I'm going to be, all these stupid names, man.
Is GearS Android Wear, or is that Tizen?
The curved Samsung watch? Tizen. That's Tizen, yeah. It has a home button on it, too. It's like...
All of it is,
It looks so dumb, I think. I mean, it's kind of cool that the display is curved, but the home button on a watch is ridiculous.
Yeah, I don't really like the way...
I don't know. I kind of like the home button. After using Android Wear and then trying to... In order to go home, you have to palm, like completely cover the display, then it goes home every time. I think it's kind of cool to have a little home button. I don't like want to do this.
I don't know. If you look at the G Watch R, it has a little gear winding button like would be on a normal watch, but I don't see why you would actually need that unless it's just supposed to look like that and act as
a 360 home has that too.
It's a power button, so it'll like actually turn on the display. I guess if you set the option, you can just push the little button to turn it on.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And then Asus, they showed pictures of a square watch, I think. The Zen watch, that will be coming at IFA also. So there's going to be a lot of smart watches coming out next week.
This feels just like when Android tablets first started coming out.
It really does.
Hundreds of companies were like they're rushing to make Android tablets, and it just wasn't working out.
Tablets!
And
yeah!
And then, you know, a month, I mean, whether it happens at the iPhone announcement or whether it's a separate announcement in a few months or even next year, the iWatch will come out, and it'll probably do the same thing that the iPad and the iPhone did, and these Android watches will be kind of rendered, maybe not irrelevant, but they'll have some catching up to do, probably. I don't know.
They'll start looking a lot more like the iWatch, inevitably.
Yeah, you'll see one come out, the Samsung model that comes out that's almost identical.
Yeah.
The S-Watch.
I'm really excited about LG coming out with a round watch now because I feel like hopefully this starts a trend where we see a lot more round smartwatches.
Well, you were excited about the 360 for the round design, and then you were kind of not excited for the 360 because it's taking so long. So does this LG G Watch R change your opinion about that at all?
I definitely still prefer the 360 because, like I said, it's more of a casual watch, and I think I could wear it in more situations than the G Watch is really sporty.
Yeah, almost looks like a dad watch.
Dad watch.
Dad watch. The dad watch.
It does. It does look like something my dad would wear. not like wear with a suit, but like wear like just,
yeah, just like
around.
Some yeah. Sperry topsiders.
Hawaiian shirt.
Hawaiian shirt, some Sperry's, you know.
Speaking of the 360, though, did you guys yo for a 360?
I did.
I did, too.
You can yo for 360?
Yeah, they ran this thing yesterday. You add Motorola as a contact in yo, and then you just send them a yo, and you're entered to win one. And at, like, 5 p.m. Eastern time today, they're going to send a yo back to people who have won. And then I guess it's kind of like, what is it, 20 people, Chris? It's like a race who can get online and submit a form first.
Yep, 20 Moto 360s. So whoever's like, I guess they're going to send it to 20 people. And if those people don't respond quick enough, then they're going to, you know, go to the next people. But apparently it's a race. So I wonder if they're going to send it to more than just 20 people and just see who can, the first 20 people.
I didn't even realize that they had yo for Android phones. I thought it was only like an iPhone thing.
Oh, it's been out for Android for a long time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, bro.
That just seems like a dumb idea that would be cool on iPhone, but that Android people would be too cool for, you know?
Too cool for?
More like iPhone people think they're too cool because they have the yo app. Android doesn't. But
but the funny thing about that was they once again marked it, the MSRP, as $250.
Yeah, that's what it's going to be. I just don't... People need to stop denying that that's how much it's going to cost.
It's like, why are we so hell-bent on it costing more than that? Like, we should be so happy that it's going to be...
You're going to feel cheated if it's $250 because you're going to be like, damn, I was really hoping this would actually be a premium price.
Yeah. Well, this is a piece of crap.
No, me, I'm just trying not to get my hopes up. I'm not going to be like, oh, yeah, it's great, it's a affordable price. And when they come out and they're like, and it's going to cost $350, and it's be like, aww.
By the way, Kevin, Yo is also officially available for Windows Phone Store. I just checked to make sure.
All right.
Because I thought it was, and yes, it is. So, yeah, iPhone users are pretty cool, I guess, but not too cool.
I mean, I'm not saying that, like, that is a slight against Android or Windows users. I'm just saying, like, it seems like such a dumb app that, you know, people make something like that, and it's like, oh, this is only on the iPhone. Yeah.
I know exactly what you mean, though. There are certain apps that... come out. And
if it's
like
a really dumb app, it seems like it should only be on iPhone.
Yeah, it's like, it'll be like a really kind of like hipster-ish weird app like Yo, and you'll never see it on anything other than iOS. Yeah. There are a lot of apps like that.
So that just kind of reeked of that kind of app, but I guess not. So now I can start yelling my Android friends.
Like Push for Pizza. That needs to come to Android.
You're still on that.
I'm still on that. I've been waiting for a pizza, man.
They should have just called it.
I want to order, but it's roulette.
All right, so that's the smartwatches. We'll have much more to talk about in our next episode. But next up, Amazon Fire Phone did not set the world on fire. There's a report that it sold only 35,000 devices,
which proves that they gamed the system to make it look like a top seller on the Amazon website.
They really did.
For a while there, it was literally the top seller. Everyone was wondering, like, wait, how is this a top seller? Who the heck's buying this thing?
I mean,
nobody was.
35,000. I mean, just to put that in perspective, something we're going to touch on a little bit is the LG G3 might be the first LG device to sell 10 million units. So, I mean, just comparatively, 35,000 is really, really
bad. I mean, I think on, like, a Galaxy S5 launch day or, like, an iPhone launch day, they probably sell 35,000 phones in 10 minutes or less.
Oh yeah, for sure. I mean, the iPhone, for sure. That thing sells, like, crazy on opening day.
They sell millions. Yeah, the first weekend, every single first weekend, it's always, like, 4 million units or 9 million, something ridiculous. But, 35,000.
So, that's... I guess... The real question, though, is, are any of you surprised?
I'm not at all.
Yeah, nobody's really surprised. I mean, I don't know. That's just, I just feel bad for the 35,000 people that got duped into buying that thing.
You know,
hey, they're probably loving it. They're soccer moms, and they're just like, dude, check out this 3D phone.
The more I think about it, like, you know, I reviewed it, tested it out, and the more I think about it, it seems like it just... Something about it feels very much like the original Droid, you know? Like, it feels like it's stuck in that era. Like, it seems like it should have come out, like, 5 years ago.
Yeah.
It's just so unintuitive and useless and heavy and thick and dumb looking. Ugh, what a bad phone.
I wonder if I will ever see one in the wild. I mean, 35,000 is pretty dang low.
It'll see, I mean, I rarely even see it. It's got four cameras.
The odds, the odds of that happening are just so low. I mean,
I barely even see Windows phones, and there's been a lot more of those sold. So,
hey, yeah. But every time you see a 1M8, you can be like, "Hey, is that a Windows phone?"
What? Get away from me!
What's Windows phone?
Yeah.
I guess the good news about the whole Fire Phone thing is that that means there won't be a sequel. I'm pretty sure, unless Amazon is bat shiznit crazy and thinks they can maybe do better next time, but that's probably going to be the last of it.
No, I'm sure they'll do another one.
I mean, you still have that device, don't you? Or
yeah, I still have it.
And I bet you've never touched it since you got done with your review.
No, I haven't. I mean, it's just not that good. You know, maybe they can do another one and improve, possibly. I think the biggest disappointment is just that this was like one of these super highly anticipated devices. We've been rumored for years. We've been talking about it for literally years since Amazon first released their first Android-based tablets, and even before then. So, I don't know. It must be disappointing for them, but
yeah, it is true. That was a super hype device way back.
And we're talking about a company like Amazon that, even though they're this huge online behemoth, they're a giant retailer, they still don't really turn much of a profit because they sell everything on such thin margins and try to, you know, they're just skating by. So this is definitely not good for them.
So, yeah, that's that. And maybe the holiday season will help them sell more devices, because I think Amazon does pretty well during that time of year.
I mean, $200 $200 is like a super high-end phone. There's no, I mean, yeah, they'll have to do a price drop now after seeing those numbers. For sure.
I mean, how many more would they have sold if it would have come out at just like, I mean, even $99 probably, they could have sold a lot more.
I'm sure we'll see probably see one with offers, you know, we'll see that version, and then I also think it's funny, I started to see TV commercials for the Fire Phone lately, and they're like, oh, it comes with Amazon Prime? It's like, yeah, for a year.
At least for, like, the term of your contract. Like, your contract is, what, 2 years? It should just be, like, for the...
I mean, it's such a dumb reason to buy it. Like, I remember writing on the day that it was announced, an article on Fandroid, the Fire Phone is the most expensive way to get a year of Amazon Prime. It's like, why buy the phone for that? Just get Amazon Prime.
I don't know. Eventually, they'll probably knock Amazon Prime to cost as much as the Fire Phone costs outright anyway. That would be a good strategy to sell some Fire Phones. Up the price of Amazon Prime to $200.
People are just like, well,
free Fire Phone.
Yeah, I guess I'll get a phone out of it, whatever.
Free Fire Phone.
And then they can just be like, oh man, we've sold so many Fire Phones. So, speaking of Fire and phones, the OnePlus One exploded in someone's pocket.
It's exploding in pants.
Another week, another exploding OnePlus One.
Another week, another negative OnePlus story. I love it.
Yeah. I mean, I guess you could say that this phone is really blowing up in their face.
I mean, so what's the full story behind this, Chris?
So a OnePlus One forum member, name's like Miyuzu. Something like that, but OnePlus forum member took to the forums and just posted up some screenshots and was like, "Oh man, my phone exploded," and it was just like so short and so casual. It was just the funniest thing. And then he posted a bunch of pictures, and it was just a OnePlus that was just boom, just completely exploded, burst through his TPU case, burst out of his pants, and like I guess it made a hole, and he had like burn marks on his skin and stuff. So It was pretty bad. I mean, yeah, it was pretty bad. And this wasn't even, like, while the device was charging, so you can't say. Maybe, you know, his house got struck by lightning. There was some kind of, you know, circuit shortage or whatever.
Or he's using a crappy charging third-party cable
or something. Or a third-party battery, which I guess we still don't know. I mean, you can't. The battery's not removable, so there goes that. But yeah, so apparently the battery just exploded, and yeah, people were just flipping out about it because, I mean, in all actuality, you know, Samsung pushes out millions and millions of units, and you hear about one or two maybe exploding because of faulty third-party hardware. Whereas OnePlus, you know, invite system, maybe, I don't know any specific numbers, but they don't really sell that many units. So for just one of them to explode randomly in some guy's pocket, that's kind of a huge issue.
Yeah, they cannot catch a break.
at all. But so I guess the forum, some of the people in there noticed that this guy actually had an issue with his charger, his official OnePlus charger, that they actually, when you buy a OnePlus, they send you the phone, and then you get a little separate box for the charger. But he noticed that his charger was, like, getting super hot. It was making his phone super hot, so it's possible it could have damaged the battery somehow. And then while he was just walking around, you know, in the subway talking to his friend, ironically, he was talking about how awesome his battery life was on the OnePlus and praising it. Like, dude, battery life is great, man. It lasts for a day. Boom, just explodes in his back pocket. They think that that could have been the issue. And OnePlus has already kind of been trying to issue, not really recalls, but taking people's RMAs and issuing RMAs for these faulty chargers. So just be careful. This is actually one of the times where you're probably better off using a third-party charging cable and charger than using OnePluses because, it's not good.
Do they not even send you the charging cable with the phone?
Yeah, that's probably cautionary.
We don't know if this is going to explode, so we're not going to give you the cable.
You know what? You don't need a charger, but...
You'll thank us later.
An invite to buy the Plus One is an invite to your death.
It's like you get an invite, and it's just like 7 days. You're like, oh god, no!
A good horror movie, like a new version of The Ring. Like, you turn on the OnePlus One, and you see the ring on it.
That's
shows
great.
Up on your doorstep. Oh god, no!
It's not a ring though. It's the OnePlus logo. You see that logo, and you have 7 days.
Poor guys.
Poor OnePlus One.
It's such a good phone. I just want to say that it is a great phone. It's I love it. Like, I was using it the other day. It was falling out of my hands because it was so big, but I loved it. It's a great phone.
Well, at least you have hands, and they're not exploded off.
And I'm actually kind of concerned about all this negative press because all the other stuff before was just, okay, it's like marketing stuff, and these guys are dicks, whatever. But with this, like a legitimate hardware failure of some sort, now I'm really concerned that I'm not going to be able to flip this OnePlus that I have for like profit. I might actually have to like break even on it or sell it.
I bet you
so
will.
Oh,
yeah.
What a shame. You can't
think
money out of it.
Just thank God for the invite process because that whole deal just it increases the resale value a lot.
All right. So moving on to some less exploded news. Apple sent out invites September 9th.
It's coming. It's official.
I can't wait. I'm so excited.
I'm seeing a lot of hype on Twitter. People are saying that they're thinking this is going to be probably the biggest iPhone event we've had for quite some time.
Yeah, but they say that every year.
I mean, they do, but these are people who don't usually say it that are saying it.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen a lot of stuff. I've seen stuff just from Android folks that are like, I don't know, it's looking pretty good. I might, you know, have to try it out and see and this and that, but it looks cool. I'm kind of excited myself.
And it looks like we're definitely going to get two different sizes, too, so that's like first. That in itself is pretty big news.
Joe, do you have an iPad or anything? Have you ever used an iPhone or iOS device?
Oh, of course I have. I mean, you can't really not ever. But I don't own any, but like I know a lot of people that do.
I don't know. Like, as an Android, and I wouldn't really consider myself an iOS user, but I do have an iPhone, and I'm pretty excited about this new one.
Yeah, I'm also just excited that the other thing that kind of gets lost in this whole news of the new iPhones is for even people that aren't planning to get the new iPhone, it's going to be the official launch of iOS 8. It should be coming up within the next week or two also. So.
Because that the last event Apple had, they talked about iOS 8, right?
Yeah, at Worldwide Developer Conference.
Okay, and that event I thought was really impressive. They had a lot of really good stuff at that event. So I have a feeling this upcoming one's going to be really good too.
Yeah, the stuff they showed off with iOS 8 really excited me. I actually haven't had a chance to check out the beta of it yet, but so I'm looking forward to having the first chance to get my hands on with iOS 8, whether that's on a new iPhone or on the 5S. It seems like a lot of cool features and, you know, the software, keyboards, things like that are going to be cool.
Looks like I should probably list my 5S on Craigslist right now before the new one comes out.
Before the rush, yeah. Now, refresh my memory. How does the... Because they'll come out with a new one, and then iOS 8 will be announced. When will the 5S get, like, the official update?
They usually will roll it out, if not, like, the weekend that they launch the new iPhone, like, within a week or so after that. Because it's going to launch, it has to be ready for launch on the new iPhone, so it's going to be release ready. So it just depends on how long it takes them to roll it out, but it shouldn't be a long wait.
Yeah, that will, I mean, anytime Apple has an event, pretty much the whole world watches. So regardless of if you're an Apple fan, you're probably going to hear lots about that. All right, next up is our good buddy Dong from Korea.
Dong!
The infamous game developer. He's being accused of copying again in his latest game, Swing Copters. And I have seen the video of the game that he's accused of copying, and there probably is a case to be made there.
Yeah, I watched that video. It does look very similar.
Yeah. So I guess just to kind of explain what's happening, we got an email, and I'm sure a lot of other sites did too, but we got an email for this indie game studio. They forget their name. They're called Open Name, but anyways, they made a game called Bog Racer that was actually, it's on iOS right now. It was on the Google Play Store, but they claimed that Swing Copters completely bit off their idea, which is just that very simple gameplay mechanic of tapping the screen to change directions, and that's it. So kind of basic. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of other games that use something similar.
See, I could make the argument that their initial idea was probably itself like a better copy of Flappy Bird, you know? It feels like that game was made in the spirit of Flappy Bird, but they were like, oh, we can just do it differently so they don't pull it off the market.
Yeah. I mean, it seems you could see the progression, like whether it was just Flappy Bird and then Swing Copters. It really seemed very like, oh, okay, this is a lot like Flappy Bird. It's just without the gravity thing and you just change it. It kind of made sense. You could see how it could have, I guess, like just progressed to that. So as far as copying goes, it was kind of like, I don't know, man. And, you know, theirs is a racing game. Not really a racing game, but it uses little toy cars and it's on a track that looks like Frogger. And Swing Copters, I could say they would have a case if Swing Copters wasn't Swing Copters, if it was just like Swing Racer or something with little cars of some sort. But
they are kind of graphically similar. Like, they both kind of use the 8-bit style.
16, yeah, that 16-bit styling. And
I mean, I think the real issue here, though, is that Bog Racer was removed from the Play Store, and Swing Copters was not, and Bog Racer came out a month earlier. I mean, say what you will about who copied who, but
exactly, yeah,
that should not have happened.
That's probably what I took the biggest issue with, was because when Swing Copters came out, of course, all these flood of actual copycat games that try to, you know, game SEO on Google Play by using, you know, swing helicopters or swinging copters.
Or just straight up swing copters.
Or just straight up swing copters. All these games that come out that try to literally just copy it, and, you know, they have these questionable permissions and all this crap, so... Google, of course, being Google, just started issuing the banhammer, and indiscriminately just anything that even semi-resembled or probably even mentioned Swing Copters in their description, I'm sure they were just completely removing from the Google Play Store. So caught up in this was Bog Racer, which came out like a month before, and it just kind of really sucks.
I mean, I don't even understand how that really happens. Like, how is Google... I mean... You'd think they would just kind of do a big search for this, and they would not include anything that came out before Swing Copters.
So if you read the comments on the article on the Fandroid, on the page, the Fandroid article, there's a nice there's a few conspiracy theories being, you know, progressed. People saying, oh, Ballgracer pulled it themselves to, like, create, like, this fake, like, drama, like, to draw attention to their game or whatever. You know, and then they had chemtrails and stuff.
Maybe, well, the funny thing is though, like, even, yeah, you could kind of make an argument for that, but in the little press release thing that they, you know, they emailed to us, they didn't even mention anything about their game. They, as far as they knew, their game was still on the Google Play Store, so they didn't even say anything like, oh, and you'll notice that our game's been removed because of Swing Copters. Like, that wasn't even a deal. Like, I was ready to hit publish, and then I go to click on their game, and all of a sudden it's just completely removed. So, very just weird, very strange, and I don't know. I don't think it's a conspiracy.
Have they followed up with any comments since then?
No, we actually emailed them, and we're just like, hey, we need, like, you know, some kind of statement, if you can, you know, tell us exactly what happened. Because usually when Google does pull your game, they kind of tell you why, like, whether right. it's, you know, some kind of takedown notice. But the Ballgracer people never emailed us back or said anything, so it's weird. It's weird.
Yeah.
And really, the whole issue with copying in video games happens all the time, whether it's, you know, Angry Birds type games or just, you know, all the, what Angry Birds copied, what was it, that tower game, it was like a medieval tower game where you shoot a catapult and kill these little guys that are in the towers, and Street Fighter copied, I don't even know what else came up back then, but you wouldn't have all these awesome games you have now if someone didn't kind of in some way or form kind of copy some of that gameplay and build upon it, which I guess is the key word there is build upon it, but so I don't really... I probably wouldn't get too mad if I was a developer and someone came out with a game very similar to mine, but, you know, with better graphics or just somehow found success. That's just the nature. It's the nature of the beast. And
yeah, I mean,
you see that stuff on, you know, Imgur and Reddit all the time. Someone will just release the same thing that someone posted, you know, a few days before, but all of a sudden it just climbs up to the charts somehow and people get all mad, like, I just posted this. But
I mean, it's definitely a frustrating thing because, you know, this Ballgracer game came out a month earlier and it has pretty much the same gameplay, and it didn't get... I'm sure they're upset because they got, like, no publicity. And then Dong, he makes Flappy Bird, so now every time he releases a game, he gets just huge hype for it.
That's the best part, was because, okay, Ballgracer, they're a small indie game studio. Their game was actually kind of darn fun. Like, I was playing the other days and showing my friends, and people were like, oh, this is awesome, I like this. And, you know, they have a little trailer for it, which, you know, they obviously had to put money into that, some company to make a trailer for them. You know, they have a website, you know, they have promo materials, all this stuff that they're putting money into, developing the game, this and that. And I looked into our old, Fandroid email, and I actually found a press release when the game came out and asking us to, you know, review it or check it out or just feature it. So, you know, they're putting all this effort in. They have a PR company, whatever. Whereas Dong... Playboy millionaire, just he just makes a game out of nowhere, like, here's Swing Copters, doesn't even tell anybody, but everybody somehow finds out because everyone's just like thinks he's this mad genius of like this game developer, and yeah, he didn't even have to try, and he gets all this publicity, trillions of downloads, climbs to the top of the charts. It's nuts. It would piss me off too, I guess, if I was that other guy, the Ballgracer people.
And then last thing I'll say about Swing Copters, which is funny, it got updated this week, and I don't know if you guys ever are playing the game.
Oh, yeah.
It got significantly easier after the update.
Did it? I don't know. I mean, you guys must be going really hard, or you guys are, like, really into it, but I saw that, and I was like, oh, sweet, I can probably get more than one now. Like, my score will probably go, like, two or three. I still can't even get past one. I'm like...
Well, my high score before the update was 6, and then, like... After it got updated, it took me a couple of tries, and I got all the way up to 24. So it's definitely a lot easier. So I just got an email about something, and I don't think this is breaking news, but we'll talk about it just because we talked about the coolest cooler on this podcast, I think, a while ago. And this thing passed the Pebble as like the most highly funded
Kickstarter ever,
which is crazy. I mean, it's a cooler.
It's the coolest cooler.
Yeah, it is the coolest cooler. The
coolest cooler, to be fair.
Honestly, this is my deal with the coolest cooler was that, yeah, I sometimes use an ice chest. But I use, like, those foam ones that fold up, you know, so they're compact and you can kind of tuck them away in your trunk somewhere. But it's huge, but there's really not that much. It doesn't look like there's that much space for like actual drinks and stuff. But and it comes with a jam lock. Guess? And you can.
Sorry, go ahead. I'm trying. I don't want you to go to the page yet, so I'm trying to cut you off. I want you guys to try to guess how much money it's made before you go check.
I'm gonna say 10 million.
Yeah, I think. I mean, I did read about this before. At the time, it was like 10 million. It might be more by now.
Yeah, it's 11,264,884.
So, oh my gosh, these guys are. I don't even think they were ready for this kind of success, but that's insane. I mean, just when it hit the 10 million mark or whatever as the most successful Kickstarter, then it got all this, you know, extra publicity, started appearing all over Facebook and all these social networks again. So then they got that extra million, boom, another extra million. Like, it's just so, it's so surreal. All that for just a cooler that has a Jambox built into it.
It's really funny because...
Hang on your own. Like, it's just...
This thing really has... I don't know why, but for every reason, it really is popular. Because I remember I wrote about it on Fandroid, I think it was last month, and it was one of our top posts of the month, just like about this cooler.
Which blew my mind.
Barely even Android related.
And I literally was like, nobody's going to like this. This is the dumbest thing. Are you serious? Like, you can charge your phone. Cool. You can bring a backup portable charger. You can, you know, play music. Cool, it's a jam box. This has a little cubby hole for a jam box. I can bring in a portable speaker. It's got a blender. Okay, I'll give it that. It's got a freaking blender built into it. But just all this stuff, and it was just like, I don't, who the heck is gonna, who's gonna buy this? But they did it. They did it.
Kevin was right all along, because I know Kevin said this on the podcast, because they came out with a model that did not sell well, and then they came out with this new one that sold like bananas. And Kevin said the reason probably was because the first one came out in winter, and this one came out in the summer. And some site interviewed the guy this week, and he pretty much said that's exactly why it went did better. So
the same exact thing. That's so nuts.
Tell you, timing is everything.
Yeah, it really is. The and by next summer, maybe you'll get one.
It's just so crazy. It's so infomercially. That's what just kind of trips me out about it. It's like, I don't know. It's a cooler that has speakers. You can charge your phone. Like, on the surface, you just see that, you know, like, soccer moms and non-tech-savvy people are probably like...
Party moms.
That is awesome. You can make blended drinks. Like, I don't even know the last time I've ever... it's been, like, 12 years since I've even fired up the blender, like, ever.
Yeah, blenders are a pain.
It's just ridiculous. It's so nuts. All right.
I'm just going to read these last two things so they don't really warrant any discussion, and then we'll get to our wins and fails and our app picks. So the LG G3, like I mentioned before, could be the first LG device to sell 10 million, which would be pretty awesome and good for LG because we like the G3. And then the HTC One M8 for Windows is going to be headed to T-Mobile in the fall. So if you need the HTC phone with Windows Phone, you can get it. All right, so Kevin, kick off our wins and fails.
All right, so I'm doing a little combo today because my one topic that I'm going over, I think it's both a win and a fail. The latest rumors suggest that Apple is finally going to put NFC in their phone and launch it with a payment service, and that's going to be a really big aspect of the new iPhone, which is cool. I think that's a win in many respects because... You know, we've been waiting for Apple to really kind of jump into the mobile payment space, and like a lot of people have put faith in Apple. Like, they kind of made the smartphone cool, they made the tablet cool, they could make the smartwatch cool. But a lot of people think that if anyone has the power and the ubiquity to kind of, you know, formalize and create a mobile payment service that people use, it could be Apple. But they haven't really put that in the iPhone yet. But so it's a win in that respect, but it's a fail because I don't know if Apple ever made any official statements on it, but kind of the word out of the Apple camp has been for so long that they were going to never use NFC. A lot of people had kind of accepted that NFC was going to die off. It was kind of a technology that just wasn't going to catch on, and that Apple would come up with, you know, some other methods like Bluetooth mixed with other types of security methods to do these mobile payments. But I guess they are going to give in to the NFC thing after all, which... is a bit of a fail. I guess it's neither here nor there, but it's kind of just like backtracking a little bit in my mind. It's cool that they finally have the payment service, but I feel like NFC still hasn't really caught on that much, and I don't know if that's the best technology to be going with for this case.
Yeah, I mean, but I think the reason it hasn't caught on, though, is because the iPhone doesn't have
exactly.
it.
Exactly. It's like what came first, the chicken or the egg, and I think, I'm not really sure how that applies here, but.
Just wanted to sound smart.
It made sense in my head. Anyways, I think if Apple really did put NFC in, it would catch on huge, because I'm sick of going places, and I have my like my Google Wallet ready on my phone, all fired up and ready to go. Then I, you know, walk to the register and find out, oh, they don't have Tap to Pay, and it's like so bums me out a lot of times. And there's places I do go where I see it and like, oh yes, they got it, and you know, I'm so excited to use it. And I think if Apple, you know, if Apple did it and all these iPhones had it, you would see it at every single register, anywhere you went to. Everything would have Tap to Pay, and it'd be great.
You know, awesome. What my fear is though is that they're gonna come out with some.
Oh, no.
Specialized thing that only iPhones can use.
Proprietary.
And they're going to have all these partners, and it's going to be like...
Gosh, dang.
That would be bad for you, Android user.
That would be the absolute worst.
Yeah, that would suck. All right. So my win of the week is going to be this guy. The HTC One Remix.
Remix!
Otherwise known as the HTC One Mini 2.
Oh, wicked,
This is supposed to be a slightly smaller version of the One M8, and I really like it, although it's not all that mini. A couple of my friends have the original HTC One, and this thing is almost the exact same size as that.
Is it slightly smaller or more narrow? I think
it's literally, like, if you look at the specs, it's literally the exact same height, but a little narrower.
Oh, okay. So, I mean, that could bring in that top corner a little bit to your thumb so that you could...
Yeah. It's just crazy to me that, I mean, 1 year ago, the
it wasn't
that
a mini.
Phone was a big flagship, and now a mini version is, like, the same size.
Yeah, it's mini.
But other than that, I really like the phone a lot. It feels great in the hand. I never have used the One M8 for an extended period of time, and I like this a lot, and it has a pretty good camera on it. It's not the weird ultra pixel thing. It's just like straight up 13 megapixel camera. The only thing is, and tell me if this is the case on the M8, Chris, does it take pictures like really quickly and make it hard to focus sometimes?
Yeah. I mean, when you... Like usually you press a button and it focuses and then snaps a shot. This one will just take a shot no matter what, if it's focused or not. So it's usually better to tap and then let it focus and then snap a bunch of pictures than just to just push the button right away. Otherwise you'd have to kinda shake the phone, it focuses, and then you push the button. So yeah, it's pretty easy to get an unfocused shot out of that thing.
Yeah, but other than that, I think it's a really good phone. If you're looking for something a little easier to hold, because, I mean, it's narrower, which definitely makes it easier to hold. So if you are into that and you're on Verizon, check this guy out.
Super jelly.
I did a review on it if you want to read that.
If only there was a Google Play version, I'd be all over that.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't used Sense in a really long time, and I did not mind it one bit, to be honest. So... all right, my fail of the week. I got to pick on Samsung again, like I do. So last Friday, they, in my mind, essentially killed the ice bucket challenge. They did basically a commercial. They basically did a commercial for the Galaxy S5 being waterproof, and the way they decided to show that was by pretending that they were somehow challenged to do the ice bucket challenge, and then they dumped the water on it, and then S-Voice said, I challenge the iPhone and HTC One and Lumia something. I just thought it was really lame. Like, okay, who challenged the Galaxy S5, for one?
Nobody.
And why did this need to be made into a marketing opportunity? It's really bad form.
I mean, I get the whole, you know, it's kind of tacky and a little, I don't know, not really thoughtful, but you could see how this would kind of go through the marketing department, like, oh, you know what's really big right now are those ice bucket challenges. We should make our phone go through the ice bucket challenge because it's waterproof. And it was just kind of, there was a lot of fail all written all over it. Like, as people in the comments mentioned too, like, if you pour water on just about any phone, it's going to be fine. You can do that to the HTC One M8. You can do it to an iPhone. It's going
to
come out.
Someone did do it to an iPhone in response. Yeah.
It's going to come out completely fine. So, what I mean, if anything, they wanted to make it a little more effective, they could have just dunked it into a bucket of ice water. But
yeah.
Even then, you know, I get the whole talk that, you know, it's insensitive and, you know, trying to use a disability and this and that to, you know, promote their phone is kind of not the way to go about things. So, but I'm not really the overly sensitive type, so for me, I just kind of thought it was interesting, but that's just me.
All right, so Kevin, or no, Chris, sorry. Yeah. I just completely mixed you guys up. Chris, what do you got for us?
My wins and fails. My win for the week is going to be Dropbox reducing their pricing. I've been a big Dropbox user for a long time now, and where Google Drive is awesome, and I love it, and it's really cheap. Dropbox just lowered their pricing and actually consolidated their plans that they had for paid pricing. Now it's just one single plan. It's $10 a month or $99 for the year, and you get 1 terabyte of storage, which is pretty impressive. And it's actually the exact same price of what Google Drive offers, but the one area where Dropbox is better than Google Drive is the fact that it on the Android apps, you can back up all your photos and this and that. Just through the app, which I think is great. And then they also have this other app called Carousel, which, you know, can organize your photos, and you can use that to share with people really quickly and easily, which I love as well. And for the paid members or customers, they also introduced a few extra new features as well. There's like some crazy new sharing features and other fun stuff, which makes it a value as well. And I like it a lot. I'm totally gonna pay for it.
Did they increase the amount of free space you get, or just what you would get if you pay?
No. Yeah, everything else is still completely the same, which I was a little surprised to find. So, kind of weird, actually, that they did do that. So, yeah, that is strange. But a terabyte is a lot. That's pretty much all the storage you'll ever need. $10 a month is a little bit. I don't know. I wouldn't. A little bit pricey, but. Again, I like the whole fact that you can back up your photos. And, you know, there is, like, those if this then that recipes where you can back up photos to Google Drive, but it's just kind of more of a hassle, and I'm always switching phones, and I don't want to have to keep downloading those apps and setting that up. So, yeah, I like it. That's my win. My fail for the week is going to be Instagram. Well, maybe more Android, I guess, but... Instagram released this awesome new application this week. It was called Hyperlapse, and I'm sure you guys have seen it. There was a lot of press on it and stuff, but it basically is a way to create time-lapse videos using your iPhone, and it looked awesome, and everyone was really cool and happy that it came out, and, you know, you go to find out there's an Android version, and it was just like, oh, we don't... it's just kind of on iPhone at the moment, and you're like, oh, okay, that's cool. But... as Wired quickly discovered after, you know, interviewing the guys at Instagram, there is not going to ever be an Android version, and apparently this has something to do with Android's camera and gyroscope APIs. The fact that they're pretty much non-existent, I'm assuming, at the moment, but kind of sucks. Kind of sucks because this is like one really, really cool app that I would love to have on Android, and I was so depressed to find out, like, it's another iOS another iOS exclusive. And it's actually been quite a while since we've seen, you know, just an iOS exclusive of anything. Like, pretty much everything these days is cross-platform, but I guess Hyperlapse is just leveraging that iOS or the iPhone's camera, which, just sucks. Sucks for us Android peoples.
Even Yo is cross-platform.
It's going to be the running gag now.
So I'm gonna read this to you during your wins fail, Chris. We got another email about this Nexus numbering system.
Oh, yes. He came back again.
So I'm going to read this quick.
He left a comment, actually, on the last week's podcast.
So this is from David Hollingshead, and this is in regard to a question we got from Tim last week, rather a comment, really. David says, Tim seems to be correct on the numbering system for Google's Nexus phones, as the Nexus 4 is the fourth generation Nexus, the Nexus 5 is the fifth generation, so while the tablets are definitely based on screen size, the last two phones do match up generationally, and I think Google did this not only to match them up generationally, but also to make an easier and more appealing reference to screen size to sell the phones with serendipity in mind. So I would say Tim is half right and Chris is half wrong.
Why do I have to be half wrong? Why can't I be half right and Tim half wrong? So, I mean, really, there's no solid answer. This would actually be very interesting to get Google's take.
We'll have the answer if they come out with a new Nexus phone.
Yeah, and exactly. Once the new Nexus phone comes out, which it's already, there's been countless rumors that it's 5.9 inches, which is 6 inches. And yes, it happens to be the sixth generation. So, I mean, you're right. We probably won't know. So, the argument's not going to be settled here. It won't be until they do a 2014 version or they do, you know, an updated model of the same screen size. Then we'll know.
Here's my kind of argument against it being generational references is simply because they had to have thought ahead a little bit and realized that, you know, if they keep going by generations, eventually they're going to release a Nexus 7 smartphone.
A Nexus 7 or a Nexus 8 or Nexus 9. It's just not, and that's just not the way we see things working nowadays. Like nothing, only movies are numbered. Even then, I guess now they just get rebooted and have subtitles. But we've seen it with Apple and stuff. You know, the new MacBook Pro 2013 edition, 2014, da da da. So that's just kind of how we see electronics go nowadays, and that's. It's cool. It was cool the way it worked out. Was like, you know, we had the Nexus 1, Nexus S, Galaxy Nexus, Nexus 4, and it was like, oh, it's the fourth generation, and it's 4-inch screen size. That's kind of cool, but I don't think it's more of a coincidence than, you know, thought out or whatever. So it's still, it applies to screen size, and I'm gonna get an official word from Google.
I think though, if you would ask Google. Tell this. They would tell you it's generation because it works out better for them if it's for the generation.
But, I mean, this is like the hard, cold evidence, and there's no disputing it, was the fact that there was a Nexus 7, and then the next Nexus 7 wasn't a Nexus 8, it was a Nexus 7 2013. So we're going to see another update to the Nexus 7 probably this year, and it's going to be Nexus 7. Well, I guess he said with the phones it's different, and the tablets, does that, but...
You're even getting confused yourself. I can see it.
It's making me so mad.
I mean, my point is just that at a certain point, the Nexus name will have to, the phone name is going to overlap with the tablet name, and I don't. Then what?
Yeah, they can't do that. So yeah, I think that's a better point, Kevin.
Right. All right. So let's get into our app picks of the week.
I'll start it off, right?
Yeah.
Chris stole my thunder a little bit. My app pick is Hyperlapse because I do. Actually, it's funny. I saw a bunch of people posting Hyperlapse videos on Instagram, and I went and I updated my Instagram app, and I was like, how come I don't have this Hyperlapse feature? I didn't even realize it was a standalone app until a couple of days ago, but then I found it, downloaded it. It is very cool.
Did you make one?
I'm waiting for some good opportunities to make some. I've done some test ones, but none that I've really been happy with to upload.
I mean, you like to bike, I know. You need to do one on your bike.
That would be really cool.
Actually, Joe, I was planning on going on a little bike ride later this afternoon and doing just that.
Ooh. Spoiler. So, sorry, I spoiled that.
Spoiler.
I look forward to seeing it. That would be cool. Where do Hyperlapses get uploaded to?
When you film it, or once it's done and compiled, and you can kind of pick the speed that you want it to play back at, then you can just choose to share to either Facebook or Instagram.
Yeah, gotcha. It saves as just a regular video on your thing. And I thought it was going to have a 15-second cap, because you know it's Instagram or whatever. But no, you can keep recording and keep going. So
sweet. Yeah, I really want to use that someday. So come on, Android. All right, my app pick of the week is an app that I discovered called Auto SMS. And so whenever I get a phone to review, this might be just a phone reviewer problem, so I don't know if this is going to apply to any of our listeners, but I like to use the review phone as my main device. So what I always try to do is I set up call forwarding to the review phone, and that works really awesome, but you can't forward your text messages natively to another device, especially if it's on another carrier. So I found this app called AutoSMS, and you just kind of turn this on. You put in the number that you want all your SMS to be forwarded to, and they all get sent to that other number. Now, you can't, like, reply to the text and have it be sent from your original phone number, but at least this way you kind of can see, like, oh, I got a text message, and if it's important, you can reply it to the person and be like, you know, it's going to be from your weird number, but you can say, hey, this is Joe, I got your text, blah, 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 and respond. Whereas beforehand, you never know that you even got a text. So, kind of cool, and I don't know how many people actually get any use out of it other than the situation I'm in, but it's neat.
Maybe people that have, like, a work phone, like, some people have, like, a separate Verizon phone, you know, yeah, and I can just have stuff forwarded over. That could be convenient.
Another solution that you could do is just use Pushbullet and have mirrored notifications. That's another way you could do it, but I like this one better.
Yeah, I always tried to use the like a Google Voice number to kind of unify when I had more than one phone, but I just never really
learned about that number. Google Voice is like the solution.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the thing. Like, I used to use Google Voice as my primary phone number. Like, that was the only number I gave out. And then I started using Windows Phone for a long time, and there was a great Google Voice app, but then towards the end when I was using Windows Phone, that app got, like, killed by Google. So I just decided I'm going to switch over to my regular phone number since I have, like, free texting and unlimited texting and all that. So now it's not so easy to when I have a review device. Oh, well.
Yeah.
Hey, what are you doing, Chris?
My app pick is going to be Bog Racer. No, actually, if it was still in the Google Play Store, I would have probably make Bog Racer because it's really cool. But if it ever comes back, no, my app pick for the week is going to be something called the Lotus.
How do you spell that?
THOLOTIS, and it's kind of similar to some of these other apps you've seen. Where it allows you to pick an image, so a wallpaper, and you can blur it, but the Lotus actually allows you to tint it as well, so it makes it a little bit darker, so it can kind of make your icons pop out a little bit more, and it's kind of awesome. So it's probably, like, the best thing I've seen to kind of do this with. So, like, I like a lot of different wallpapers and this and that, but a lot of times they're just too busy. You know, I find one that has a bunch of really cool colors I like, and they're just too busy and too crazy. So, you know, you can kind of blur it out so it makes it look like your icons are in focus while the background's kind of defocused. And then you can tint it as well, which makes the icons pop out even more. And it's just really cool, really easy to use, and awesome. So I think if you're into wallpapers and all that stuff, the funnest, check out the Lotus.
Sweet. All right, before we leave, we have one question here from Rob Jackson.
Jackson?
I think you guys know who that is.
Action Jackson.
He asks, if for free you could have any of the upcoming smartwatches or Google Glass, which one would you take? You cannot resell them.
Google Glass.
I would say smartwatches, absolutely no contest.
Is he asking reason... to pick which one of the smartwatches we want?
No, just any of those or Google Glass.
Yeah, smart
you guys also have to give a reason, though. Give a reason why.
Because I don't want to wear anything on my face.
I don't want to look like a douchebag.
I don't want to look like Chris Chavez.
You're saying, like, because if it's right now at this moment, the Google Glass that's available would not be compatible with a set of glasses that I think would look cool. So, like, I'm not really.
Yeah,
fair enough. I would just say Google Glass because it does a lot more than Android Wear, and just using both of the platforms without dorkiness coming, you know, or just self-consciousness, whatever. If it actually looked cooler, it would be awesome because it's just it's much more functional as far as an OS goes or a wearable OS. You could do a lot more, and it's just easier to use, the Timescape UI and all that stuff. Not really the biggest fan of Android Wear at the moment, but maybe, you know, down the future
Speaking
I will be.
Speaking of Google Glass, though, I actually last week I was out out like Friday or Saturday night, and it was the first time I've seen someone wearing Google Glass outside of like a tech event that I've been to, because we go to like CES or some of these events
Oh, yeah.
wearing Google Glass, but it was the first time I saw just a guy on the street Where, well, that's probably not fair because it was the people they were walking home from Otakon, so that kind of makes sense that someone at Otakon would be wearing Google Glass. But yeah, the first sighting of Google Glass in the wild for me.
Anyway. That's cool. I have yet to have that experience. I look forward to the day. Not really, but whatever. Yeah. Okay, so just a quick announcement. Next week is going to be craziness. There's a Motorola event Thursday. Samsung things going on Wednesday. Chris is going to be traveling. So we will not have an episode next week. There's just going to be too much going on. But we'll be back the week after that to talk about all of it. So definitely make sure you tune in for that. But without further ado, you can send us an email with our address, podcast@mobileroar.com, if you want to yell at Chris about Nexus numbers again. We always enjoy that. You can subscribe to the podcast on Stitcher Radio, iTunes, Windows Phone Store, pretty much anywhere else. You can follow us on Twitter. Chris is at GamerCore, Kevin is at YouDon'tKnowKev, and I am at TallShmo. And we will see you guys in 2 weeks to talk about tons and tons of stuff. So see you then.
Bye. Bye, guys.